here some other time, but it just didn't work. And after spending so many hours at the airport. But it appears to me that having apologized, as I must, I apologize for having let you down last night. But as they say, there's always some silver lining that they clap, that cloud, every that cloud. So had I come that day, I've just confirmed that had I come that day, I would not have had the opportunity to unveil this movie. Which is something very important to me. The theme of my presentation is the history of our struggle, reflections on the history of our struggle. Of course, within the context of this particular lecture. As a prelude to my speech, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to recall some of the messages that came through on SAFM radio on the morning of 21 March this year, because by that day I was already aware of the fact that I would have to come here and speak to you. So I listened carefully to the comments that came through that morning on radio SAFM. I think I must refer to these comments that I had because they provide an interesting context to my speech. And here are some of them. I just picked up some of them. One, let us honor everybody. ANC did not alone bring our freedom. Teach correct history. Don't hijack the occasion. Where we are because we did not listen to him. Hopefully, my speech will tell you who this him is. Do as he preached. What does Freedom Day mean to us? Is Mrs. Sobukwe still alive? She is not witchcraft. You did not play the voice of Sobukwe, but Nelson Mandela's voice. They were challenging the radio presenter on 21 March. The radio presenter played in the background Mandela's voice. Somebody phoned in and said, but you didn't play Sobukwe's voice in the background on 21 March? Naming the day human rights and not Sharpeville Day is to marginalize Sobukwe. These are the remarks that came through. I didn't invent it. No human rights without men. Expropriation without compensation took place years ago. Now, it would be wrong for any people not from time to time create debates among themselves. Because it's through debate that we refine our thoughts and ideas. And that's why I said this morning that I would be happy to come and address people, but I'd be even more happy if students were to be there. But that said, ladies and gentlemen, occasions such as this enable us as a nation to reflect on our past, to reflect on our history. The past is an integral part of our present and our future. And as my good friend, Professor Njabulo Ndebele, once put it, quote, the past is knocking constantly on the doors of our perceptions, refusing to be forgotten because it is deeply embedded in the present. To neglect it at this most crucial of moments in our history is to postpone the future, unquote. Depending on its impact, a past event sometimes just simply refuses to recede to the background, thus continuing to be part of the present. How often do we hear words like, I still remember it vividly, as if it happened yesterday, about something which happened many years back. And indeed, sometimes we even swear to carry the past right into the future. And we say, I will never forget this for the rest of my life, carrying it directly forever into our future. Taking history into our future. But history is useful only if it is honestly recorded, only if it is not manipulated, and only if it is not distorted. Yet experience has never ceased to reveal these malpractices. Distorted history has the potential to polarize people and to cause divisions and hate. This is because, invariably, there is a lurking evil motive behind every single distortion of history. History, properly recorded and understood, will enable future generations to know who exactly Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe was, to know exactly what he stood for, and why he was feared and hated by some, yet loved and revered by others. Not that he wanted to be revered or rewarded, that is not what he was after. What he wanted was that everyone be allowed to enjoy at least their basic rights. Properly recorded, history would show that he too played a major role in the struggle against apartheid. History, accurately recorded, ladies and gentlemen, and that is the importance of it, provides points of reference for future generations, which is why distorting history is almost criminal. While distorting history is bad, not remembering it at all is worse. Our recollection of past events culminates in commemorations, which are fine, but there is a caveat, there's a warning about that. Please commemorate by all means, but commemorate properly and appropriately. Without taking sides in one or some of the debates on the radio that we just heard, and bearing in mind that we are honoring Sobukwe, let me use the event of 21 March 1960 in Sharpeville to illustrate the point of properly celebrating an event. But before doing that, let me start with a basic refresher, a very basic one indeed. You know, let's start there. Any event, and we're trying to analyze the concept of commemoration and what it is, the essence of it, so that we can understand properly why we should commemorate and what, how we should name those commemorations. Anyway, as I said, let me start there. Any event sought to be commemorated comprises two important elements. Firstly, a date, of course. Like 21 March 1960. This tells us when the event happened. Secondly, and that is the second element to a set commemoration, there must be context around the date. That is, something of significance must have occurred. Otherwise, a particular date on the calendar will come, go, and just be forgotten like any other date. Let me give you an example. Who remembers amongst you, say, 11 August 1993? If I were to ask you, do you remember 11 August 1993? You would probably ask, by the way, what happened on that day? Because you can't recall and reconnect to 11 August 1993 unless you cross-reference it with a particular event. But if I were to ask you, what happened on the 28th of February? 1978, I'll get a prompt answer. So, if nothing comes to mind, a date such as the fictitious one which I've given almost never existed. It has no impact and it's of no significance. And this is because, as the author Gulen puts it, this is because time and space are innocent. And as I said to some people, they are, time and days are simply neutral to the activities of mankind. Yesterday is not what's not interested in you or your life, whether you were born or died yesterday. Yesterday, the 9th of May, was not interested in you. Because any day is neutral to your activities. Therefore, for any date not to be neutral and abstract, but to get entered onto our calendars every year, to be entered and be embedded into our numbers, and to be continuously commemorated, something worth remembering must have happened. For example, 21 March is each year marked on a calendar of commemoration because many people, 69 in number, were killed by the police and many injured in Sharpeville on the corresponding date in 1960. We must therefore all agree, shouldn't we, that changing the date to 21 March as the yearly calendar day for the commemoration of what happened in Sharpeville to another date would be a blatant distortion of history, wouldn't it? It would in fact no longer be the same event you claim to commemorate. The date 21 March as an element in the commemoration is therefore immutable, it's unchangeable, you can't change that. Just as 16 June is with regard to Youth Day. You can't claim or purport to be celebrating Youth Day on the 18th of August. It's just not it. But now that we know, you all agree that you are not allowed to change the date, is it permissible, though, to tamper with the second element of a commemoration, namely the nature of the event as a context or subject of the commemoration? Are you allowed to tamper with that? Maybe call 21 March for tracker day. Are you allowed to do that? If you do that, you violate the second element of the commemoration. Now, you may do so, provided the true nature of the event sought to be remembered is not lost. Otherwise, that would also amount to distortion of history, I think. You might end up really, really not commemorating what happened in Sharpeville on 21 March 1960 at all, but something else. It is against this background, ladies and gentlemen, that some of the comments on the radio should be understood. For a commemoration to be proper and appropriate, for it to serve its true purpose, none of the two elements should be compromised, the date and the true nature of the event to be celebrated. The date of the month on which the event to be remembered occurred cannot be changed, as I've said, and secondly, the events sought to be remembered must be properly referenced. Properly referenced, ladies and gentlemen, in the sense that, and this is what repeating, the nature of the event which occurred on that day is not changed, it's not lost. Absent any one or both of these elements, you will be commemorating something else, and that would not be an appropriate and proper commemoration of the event. Now, ladies and gentlemen, every country has its own unique history to tell, and how fitting it is that I'm speaking to you today in a museum which is a conservatory of history in itself. Every country has its own unique history to tell that at one time or the other, it faced. faced adversity. But among its people, there are always, and there will always be, men and women with the capacity to enable the nation to rise to these challenges and to triumph over them. There will always be such people. But who are these people? Again, Gulen, the author, you know, the writer, speaks of two kinds of people. Those he calls useless people, on the one hand. And on the other hand, those he calls people of sense. Well, as for the first category, that is the useless people, he says, I quote, "The stomach expels food that cannot be digested and has no benefit to the body." Time and history does the same to useless people. He says, people of service are those who, quote, understand that they are responsible and answerable for work left undone. They are extraordinarily resolved and hopeful, even when their institutions are destroyed and their plans upset and their forces routed. Unquote. These are the people who do not give up, the service people. They stand up and pick up their spear again. We have been gifted with such people, amongst them, Sobukwe, the service people. A look into our recent history as a nation will show that some good can arise out of tragedy. It really can. Out of the tragedy of the abominable policy of apartheid. The resilience of the majority of the people of all races, by the way, who were against it, was tested to the limit, but prevailed. It brought together people of different ideologies. It glued together Africans, so-called colors, Indians, and whites. It glued together men and women. It glued together the young and the old. Yet, as Mandela once put it, ironically, painful as apartheid was, the struggle against it produced great men and women. It afforded them the opportunity to demonstrate their vision and courage of conviction. Painful and present memories, ladies and gentlemen, compete for space. And they must be allowed to compete for space. Is there room for both? Especially room for painful memories? As the life of our young nation continues to evolve, is there room for painful memories? As we wrestle with the task of fashioning our identity as a nation, the answer, I think, should be yes. There is space for both, including painful memories. This is because most of them are lessons for the future. They are part of the present. They shape our perceptions. As they jostle for space in our lives, they present a nation with the opportunity to consider options in ordering its affairs. Whether present affairs or future affairs, they help us make informed decisions, painful as these memories are. They guide us into coming to informed decisions, guided by wise hindsight, which is born out of the painful past. Perhaps that explains why people say we in South Africa have come up with the best constitution in the world. This is because, as Prof said, I was there. This is because as we drafted our constitution there in Captain Park, we had on the table a vivid picture of our horrible past, including 21 March 1960. We found those painful experiences in the past. We might have defaulted on a good constitution. We might have taken certain things for granted. But we're vigilant, thanks to those painful memories of the past. That hindsight continued to dictate our nation's path once the constitution was already in operation. The great task of properly interpreting the new constitution and applying it still lay ahead. A task that was to be as difficult as the drafting itself. Again, hindsight, our tragic past, stepped in, played a role, and gave us some wisdom. We should not interpret the constitution with our eyes closed to the past, and we cannot. Otherwise, we'll go back to the past. As the late Chief Justice Mohammed once reminded us, the objective of the new constitution was to make a clean break with our tragic past. The past that we all knew, the past that we must all know, whether you are a born free or no born free. We must know that past. The past which future generations must know. And by the way, speaking of interpreting the constitution, we have in the mind of others, other people, we have been, as it were, we have been over influenced by the horrors of the past. That we have, in some instances, been over-liberal and over-progressive. Because our constant fear of the past, the horrible past. And as I once said, some people say we have, in some instances, gone overboard in interpreting the Constitution. To such an extent that we have become so permissive a society that once something or anything is permitted anywhere in the world, you can rest assured that it's permitted in South Africa. Something exists. But they warn you, be careful. What is permitted in South Africa would not necessarily be permitted in other countries. When I was a judge, if you allow me to deviate a bit, to illustrate this point, when people say we go over, I was the judge president. I met one of the chiefs from the rural areas. And there was talk in the newspapers that there was a case in which people wanted, if I may use that word, I didn't invent it, prostitution to be allowed. And that chief walked past me into my office and said, "Judge Ngoepe, I can assure you, even if you people can allow prostitution in my area, in my troubled area, we'll never allow that. We don't care what you judges are going to say. We will never allow such a thing. Because in this view, we would have gone overboard." So there are such issues. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are talking history and we're reflecting on it and the good we can get out of it. But history is to be shared. Must be shared. Some of us are in a generation that has direct experience of the painful past, of the difficult transition, and of the not so wonderful present. The past experience that we have experience of being barred from entering certain areas or premises, or indeed even barred from spending a night in the Orange Free State. Therefore, it behoves us to share those experiences with the younger generations, not for the purpose of nurturing division and hate, but to enable them to navigate the present and the future. We may choose to share the past by passing it down through word of mouth around fireplaces, in itself a practice of some respectable history, or we may share the history by recording it. But for goodness sake, let us pass it down to future generations. We cannot afford to wipe out of our history the likes of Sobukwe. You can't. In fact, that is what he meant when he warned that Africa would never forget. Sobukwe would understand that nobody and no organization could legitimately take credit for a victory against apartheid to the exclusion of other people or organizations. Doing so would amount to a mischievous distortion of history. Such a perception on the part of anybody would demonstrate lack of understanding of the true dimensions of the struggle against apartheid. For anybody to claim credit, or any organization to claim credit for themselves, the exclusion of others, is a manifestation of lack of understanding of the nature, the depth, the width, and the dimension of the struggle against apartheid. The late Judge Higginbottom, a great African-American, once chided a member of the South African Student Organization back in 1982, in my presence, for thinking that we could win the struggle without outside help. Higginbottom, himself a contributor to our struggle, challenged him to name one country in the world which had won a struggle against oppression without outside help. The struggle against apartheid, ladies and gentlemen, belonged to all. No particular event singularly turned the tide. The triumph was the result of an accumulation of events, such as Sharpeville, and of the concerted effort and sacrifice by many people of all races, such as, of course, yes, Sobukwe. That is what he would have understood. He would not take all the credit for himself or for his organization. From Sobukwe, we have come to learn that while you may restrict or even take away a person's physical freedom of movement, you cannot imprison their freedom of the mind. I had Professor Bali today allude to that. The writer Gulen again includes it this way to demonstrate that we cannot imprison anybody's mind. He says, and I quote, "Many people who are actually imprisoned or in chains remain free in their conscience and so do not feel their imprisonment." On the other hand, he says, "Many others, however, do not taste the true meaning of freedom, although they inhabit the vast spaces of palaces and gardens." Unquote. Well, as to the kind of people who, despite imprisonment, who still feel free in their mind, I've given you Sobukwe as an example. As for the second category of people, who are really not free despite the fact that they have monies and all sorts of things. As for this category, you don't have to go very far. We have people who have bought palaces with large gardens, both here and abroad, with ill-gotten monies. Mm. But they are not free. They are in hiding. They are jumping from one country to the other, giving them palaces. So that is not free. It's not the kind of freedom we value. It's the first type of freedom that we do with. I've never had the privilege of meeting Sobukwe in person. I do not, for that deprivation, I don't understand the fact that that could be the result of an age gap between us. That's acceptable. What I and many others do resent is that the deprivation was the result of him being kept away from us by a vicious system. That's what we resent. But for that system, had it not been for that system, this country could have been better than it is today, because many young men and women would have learned so many things of virtue and value from him. The gospel he preached could have been spread wider and understood better. But for that vicious system, the opportunity was lost to learn at the feet of a great teacher, not only an academic, but a teacher of values. It was not for nothing that they affectionately nicknamed him Prof. Did Prof, though, did he meet the strict criteria to be a good teacher? Did he meet this strict criteria which are set by Mencius, a Chinese philosopher? Mencius says, and as I'm going to go through this strict criteria prescribed by Mencius, please put Sobukwe against them. I quote, "If a gentleman teaches in five ways, the first is by a transforming influence like timely rain. The second is by helping the student to realize his virtue to the full. The third is by helping him, the student or her, to develop his her talent. The fourth is by answering his questions, the student's questions. And the fifth is setting an example others not in contact with him can emulate. These are the five ways in which a gentleman teaches," unquote. Now, against those criteria, I've challenged you to measure Sobukwe up against them. And well, you may want to give the verdict yourselves on the Prof. I leave it to you to judge. Certainly, there are indications that it is us who have failed to learn. The teacher was there, it is us who failed to learn. To learn from this great teacher of life. To learn the values which he espoused. In so doing, in failing to learn, we have failed him. We have failed ourselves. Indeed, we might have failed our country. And even more frightening is that we might have failed and betrayed future generations, but thereby betraying a nation's future. Because, ladies and gentlemen, if you betray a nation's future, if you betray future generations, you are betraying the future of a nation. The consequences of our failure to learn and imbibe these values are all around us ought to see. Just look around. People masqueraded as champions of the poor and the masses, when in fact, they were there to serve their own interests and enriching themselves. We have heard of rampant corruption, nepotism, etc. We have failed to learn that serving people is not about putting your own interests first. We have failed to learn that serving people is not even about putting the interests of your political party above the interests of your country. No, ladies and gentlemen, it is not about, or rather, it is about putting the interests of the country and the people first. And these are the values that he has taught, which some of us failed to learn and to imbibe. That's why we have, for example, this dubious distinction of being a nation with the widest divide between the rich and the poor, despite the resources we have in the country. That is why economic growth has ground to hardly 1%. The number of the unemployed, as we speak right now, runs into millions. Need I say more? He must be turning in his grave, pipe and all, when he sees his things. Oh, yes. So Sobukwe was, of course, the founder of the PAC. But there is one mistake which we should never make. Namely, to try and judge his legacy with reference to the political fortunes, or dare I say, misfortunes of the present PAC. We dare not measure his legacy against that. And I have reasons for it. I say so because, for one thing, his vision was not just for the PAC, but for the entire country as well. Indeed, as you see in the library, for the entire continent. In any case, who knows as to what course would the PAC have taken had he been unchained? It would have been different things, isn't it? So we dare not judge his legacy with reference to the position of the PAC. Sobukwe was a visionary. He envisioned a democratic country, free of racism and sexism, but at the same time, he foresaw that could never be achieved unless the issue of land was resolved. He knew that central to the struggle was the issue of the land. The cause we hear today are not new. They are merely echoing what he said many, many years ago. Yes, people may differ on the mechanism to achieve the resolution of the issue of the land. But that does not detract from the validity of the call he made many years ago, before it became fashionable to do so. I therefore say, yes, Sobukwe may be dead, but he's still alive, because his call for the resolution of the issue of the land is still ringing in our ears, and will continue to do so until the matter is resolved. Of course, I must hasten to add, resolved fairly and in accordance with the law of the land, and not in the manner as we see these past few days on television. Mm. He was not a champion of chaos and disorder. Mm. He was a lawyer, by the way. Mm. So when being the kind of person he was, much I felt he had not done enough for his people by the time he died in 1978. Yet, he had played his role. Ladies and gentlemen, he owes us nothing. Absolutely nothing. On the contrary, it is us who remain deeply indebted to him and to his dear wife, our mother, which is why the caller on the radio asked whether we were looking at time. It was a legitimate call. No self-respecting nation, no nation that is proud of its own history, fails to honor its heroes and heroines who stood up and took the bull by the horns in the face of adversity. We have not lost our soul for political expedience, or have we? Mm. Hopefully not. We know that we have, through no fault of ours, missed the opportunity to learn from him everything he could offer, and there was a lot he could offer in the union. Yet, we should heed what the poet Mildred Johnson says in one of her poems, in which she exhorts us not to try to look for another Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe. Don't try to look for another one in our midst. Because Mildred says, or according to her, because God would have made only one Robert Mangaliso Sobukwe, and only one. So don't try, let us not try to go and look for another one, she says. So, now that we cannot go and try and look for another Robert Sobukwe, what do we do? What should we do? We should go back to write and learn our history properly. That's what we should do. We should learn, imbibe and nurture the values that the likes of him espouse. That's what we should do. Now, as I close, here is, and as a tribute to Sobukwe, let me read Mildred's poem, which I've alluded to, which she wrote as an ode to somebody she called the Little Warrior. The title of the poem is, "We Live More Like the Little Warrior." That is the title of that poem. "We Live More Like the Little Warrior." And then the poem goes, it is someone to hear a battle cry for justice, someone to take up shield and mighty spear, it is someone to bear the wounded on their shoulder, it is someone to listen for a call and then hear. It is someone to fight in mankind's deepest battles. It is someone to go to front lines, fearless, strong. It is someone to see the warfare through to victory. Someone to cry for freedom, loud and long. We need more like this mighty little warrior. But certainly, after all is said and done, we need not search forever for another one. Because we know, indeed, that God made only one such person, and that is Sol. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to me.